So with this, I think I'm going to talk about my own vision of this field and what it can contribute, both as a professional clinical psychologist as well as forensic psychologist who has worked for about 4 decades before I have decided to present something today in this platform. Now today, when I talk of mental health for all and the theme of 2020, mental health for all being the theme of 2020, from that time I was contemplating that mental health professionals of that time Rashtriya Raksha University, they started an online counseling services of share and care for COVID-19 warriors and caregivers. Now, social distancing for long time during COVID-19 pandemic resulting in anxiety, depression, frustration, feeling of helplessness, loneliness, and losing patience were obvious, and they were finding it difficult to cope with the uncertainty. In fact, the timely psychosocial intervention with a fresh look at the consequences of physical and social distancing from the loved ones gave a clear insight to its impact on mental health issues in all age groups. In fact, contemplation on the impact of physical and social distancing from the loved ones on mental health prisoners, on the mental health of prisoners, convicts and juveniles and their families was something that I was long time thinking of, and that is what has resulted in this proposal today. And to create mental health service facility to address emotional and psychological needs of prisoners, convicts, juveniles and their families for their mental well-being during custody and our imprisonment. Now, from where did I get these kind of ideas is my experience of working at Hospital for Mental Health, medical colleges, and in the prison setup. It was an intense learning opportunity for me that helped me in exploring the challenging terrain of suspect interrogation in the forensic laboratory that led to the establishment of forensic psychology discipline in India. Now, during these 4 decades of my tenure in suspect interrogation, my main emphasis was on interview techniques and psychological assessments. Polygraph examination or technologies like layered voice analysis, suspect detection system, BIOS, or brain fingerprinting, they were used only as adjuncts to generate physical correlates of the evidence to supplement the forensic psychological assessment reports for crime investigation in forensic psychology division. When suspects, witnesses, and accused were brought for crime investigation, see, this I felt this time when I was looking about my COVID cases, I mean COVID people who used to come for share and care services. Even those people at those time, they used to have the same experience of distress resulting in irritability, anxiety, depression, frustration. They were also feeling helpless, lonely. They were finding it difficult to cope because they were not knowing the consequences of the test and the result. So all those things were to be handled in our pre-test interview. In fact, that is how, and that was the reason, first time I felt that renaming of lie detector division as forensic psychology was much needed. And for this, probably I must have persuaded the proposal for more than 3-4 years with Government of Gujarat to see that lie detector was renamed as forensic psychology in 1988. But that was the time I learned that before subjecting all the suspects for detection of deception tests, in their pre-test interview, it was the forensic counseling that had helped them in bringing them to almost normalcy and accept to undergo the test of detection deception willingly. And this experience was a learning to share now as I embark on the discussions on increasing access to mental health services for prisoners, convicts, and addressing the deviance per se. Now, when I talk of this, I also wish to share the observation as a forensic psychologist. In fact, as a forensic psychologist investigating the crimes, when any deviation from the norms were observed in systematic investigation, it immediately drew my attention. It was a surprise to discover that past history of mental illness in few suspects accused of serious crimes were found. They were treated cases of mental illnesses, but not on medication or not on follow-up. But when they were apprehended as suspects and were referred for detection of deceptions, they were identified as peripheral members of organized crime units. Especially in cases of riots, mob violence, a careful tracking of past medical records reflected psychiatric intervention for mental illnesses. However, when they were suspected of a crime and were they were brought for the investigation, none of them reported their past history of mental illness to us. But how we came to know about this is like when Godra accused were all referred for polygraph examination and narcom. None of them had revealed that they had any kind of history where they had undergone some kind of a depression or anxiety for which they had taken psychiatric intervention. But during the course of time, after all the examinations were over and report was submitted to the court, someday suddenly when the court summoned the concerned psychiatrist and the psychologist who had conducted narco analysis, that was the first time we came to know that the person who was subjected to narco analysis also had a past history of depression. See, that is how it is the field work which gave us a lot of insight into understanding the overlap of the forensic psychology as well as clinical psychology. It is this work experience of these both domains of clinical and forensic, it made me realize one important truth, and that is even the most organized complex of crimes are already rehearsed in the mind of the perpetrator. So while physical evidence of some crime scene may get lost in due course of time, the experience of crime remains preserved in the storehouse, that is mind and body, of the perpetrator and victim. Now, forensic psychologists try to tap this storehouse for crime scene for detecting the deceptions. Now, when the same thing is used by clinicians, they tap the same thing for either healing or for psychotherapy. Now, when I tell you the experience stored in the mind-body realm, I have tried to graphically represent this. See, naturally, when a thought first occurs to the mind, there is nothing associated with it. It is so slowly the sensation that aroused because of the thought in the body gives rise to the perception. And during this perception, it evaluates the thought and the feeling. The recurring thought associated with the sensation is what that evaluates, and that is how it creates sensory motor imageries. And this is what leaves some kind of a physical traces in the body in terms of those thoughts and desires. And that is what, when it comes out as in the form of action, that is what we call as experience. And by the time, you can see in the graphic representation, when the thought has arisen to do something negative, the person is still in the normal state of mind only. But by the time he decides to do and after he executes, his whole mind and body state becomes like this, where it remains that way for lifetime. And this is what probably the neuroscientists and neuroscience experts try to develop it as tapping the memory through the brain. And the psychophysiologists try to tap it as memory through the psychophysiology to assess deception in polygraphs. Now, when we look at the behavior of victim and offender, the recent flood of sexual violence cases against women and children and surge of Me Too movement reflect that perpetrators often have mental health and psychosocial risk factors that trigger to maintain and perpetuate the crimes. But when victims and offenders are not rehabilitated, the impact of crime on their mental health is immense, resulting in mental health issues. That is where offenders will have the tendency to repeat offending in a deceitful manner, and which increases, leading to criminality. Or slowly it may transform them to become deceptive predator, freely exploiting the vulnerable victim till they get in conflict with law. See, it is these understandings and the research studies, if you look at it, the forensic investigation of physical, mental, emotional, and social and economic crimes against women and children indicates the need of psychological intervention for victim protection and rehabilitation. Once again, the psychological intervention for offenders to prevent them from reoffending, and psychological therapies is the only thing that can help in rehabilitating the victim for mental well-being and prevent the offender from reoffending. So when clinical and forensic psychology here can play a constructive and crucial role in educating in assisting the criminal justice agencies in these areas. Now, thus today I have made an effort to bring in my presentation the need of forensic mental health services to address the deviance so that the justice can be restored. Now, when I say need of mental health services to victims and offenders, some victims of crime try to seek the help of mental health professionals for the recovery of mental well-being. But the stigma and the sympathy are the barriers to seek mental health services. Psychiatrists and clinical psychologists are working in the field of mental health services to provide service to victims only when they seek for medical or mental health help in the setups. But no mental health service setups are established exclusively for their therapy or rehabilitation. Now, offenders are another lot who are completely rejected, condemned, because of which they are also deprived of mental health services unless they suffer from serious mental disorders. So both victims and offenders, they suffer from mental health issues and both need the intervention of mental health professionals. Now here it is important to know the provisions of Mental Health Care Bill. Now when I talk of Mental Health Care Bill 2017, the Act clearly mandates the state to provide adequate, efficient and quality mental health intervention to the prisoners. Section 103(7) of the Act directs that the mental health establishments inside the prisons shall be registered with either the central or state mental health care boards and that they should conform to prescribed standards and procedures. The state is also obliged under Article 21 of the Constitution to protect not only the physical but also the mental health of persons in its custody. And that is how today, if I can talk about the most recent study, probably all of you must have seen an article in the Quint that has appeared on 17th July, where the Quint has brought out the mental health crisis and the vulnerability of prisoners to mental health issues in various jails of Tihar prison complex. The Quint has also moved RTA applications to all the 16 jails of the Tihar prison complex, the jail hospital, and the prison legal department to seek the data on how mental illnesses are identified, addressed, and treated by the prison authorities and healthcare boards. And it is there, you can see the statistics that has come out very clearly in their RTI, that Tihar jail is a breeding ground for mental health crisis. There has been an increase of 70% increase in the deaths of suicide in Delhi Tihar jail from 16. 92% of deaths by suicide were under trial prisoners. 100% of women who died by suicide were under trial prisoners. Now 100% of women prisoners currently diagnosed with mental health issues are accused of offenses under the Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substance Act. In fact, there is no mental health establishment either even in women prisons or in adolescent prisons. Now, when I talk of these things, today, in fact, yesterday, I suddenly came across the some kind of a comment, I would say that suggestion from the NIMHANS in the news, that they have suggested something like a gatekeep opening or gatekeeper kind of a provision where these kind of cases can be referred and they will be helped out in terms of treatment. But certainly, these quick solutions are not the solutions unless we are ready to take the responsibility as mental health professionals, as well as state and central, that we are also obligated to give. And we are obligated means it is their right to see that their mental health care services are provided. So with this, that is where I would like to address whether it is mental disorders, mental disabilities, or the deviants. All of them have to be addressed on one continuum in an all-inclusive manner. And this calls for all the stakeholders, maybe police, judiciary, mental health professionals, like psychiatrists and clinical psychologists and psychiatric social workers, forensic psychologists and criminologists to work as a team. And I consider myself privileged to have pioneered forensic psychology as a professional clinical psychologist. And clinical forensic psychology has generated a lot of interest in the forensic scientists, criminologists, behavioral scientists, crime investigators, students and researchers of the criminal justice system. That is how probably Forums such as these are an indication of the need to explore the challenges and prospects of these two professions. Now, when I talk of this, I suddenly go back to my old memory, where when I was visiting Sabarmati Central Prison as a clinical psychologist, it was a learning experience to know the prevalence of clinical symptoms of mental illness convicts during their prison term. When they were in and out during prison term, roughly 5 to 7%, I'm talking of my time, of convicts with no reported history of mental illnesses had developed clinical symptoms which required psychiatric intervention with medications. They were referred to the dispensary in the prison premises for the assessment and psychological therapies when I was working there as a visiting clinical psychologist. This I am talking of sometimes in 1985-90. And in fact, it is this which led me to start Buddha Psychological Services in 2012 at Institute of Behavioral Sciences, Gujarat Forensic Science University, when both clinical and forensic psychologists used to visit Sabarmati Central Prison for the assessment, intervention, and rehabilitation of the prison inmates requiring psychological therapies. Now, when I talk of this contribution of forensic psychologists in forensic laboratories, this is something which I'm quite disappointed in the sense forensic psychologists in most of the forensic labs have limited themselves to only suspect interrogation and detection of deception. They evaluate crime scene photographs, police documents, postmortem reports, mobile forensic reports, carry out pretest interviews. They understand the crime as it has occurred in a very comprehensive manner. They prepare the questionnaire required for conducting polygraph examination. They appear in the court of law as experts for evidence. They do all these things. That is wonderful. But their whole concentration is limited to detection of deception. They don't address issues of competency, which was also brought into the notice by our yesterday speaker, Dr. Sudhanshu Sarangi, in terms of risk assessment, competency to stand trial, eyewitness testimony, are as working as custody evaluations for family courts are reconciliatory to Lok Adalats or disability evaluations. And that is where I came up with this new idea of suggesting forensic mental health service units as one-stop solution. That is how there is a need to develop a service model for psychological assessment and psychological therapies, but in a safe and secure unit settings. I see this as a first step of interdisciplinary application for mental health professionals. As mental health professionals, we should feel very proud of, because both psychiatrists and clinical psychologists, though they are considered as mental health professionals in Mental Health Care Bill 2017 to treat the offenders and victims with psychological therapies, but they do it only when they're referred, right? So let us remember to follow the laws, rules and regulations needed for ethical practice of this profession. And that is how, as a first step to set up a safe and secure forensic mental health service units to introduce psychological therapies for offenders and victims as intervention is my proposal. And this helps in preventing reoffending, without which talking of reducing recidivism is only a mirage. Now, that is how I have come out with some guidelines for prisons and juveniles homes, where a separate forensic mental health service units can be set up in prisons attached to the medical dispensary for catering to the indoor convicts. And in open jails and juvenile homes and behavioral science departments, outdoor services can be started to train professional clinical and forensic science. We have to train one set of professionals who are both clinical as well as forensic. That is where clinical forensic psychologist and clinical criminologist as mental health professionals to provide therapy to offenders in open jails, prison, and juvenile homes to lead crime-free lives when they are released. See to it. Now, the next thing is to introduce a neurocriminology module for reasoning and rehabilitating for treating the antisocial behavior in both indoor and outdoor services in forensic mental health service units. Now, when I talk of this, only then therapeutic jurisprudence for the restoration of justice is possible, only by introducing psychological therapies for healing both victims and offenders of the crime. Now, when I say this, I have also proposed some kind of guideline which can be set up in both medical and mental health setup. And this, I feel, is very valid looking to the proposal that has come up from NIMHANS in today's news. A need to develop a clinical forensic psychology as a discipline to establish forensic mental health service units in any hospital setting or in mental health setup will to provide OPD services to victims and their families of all crimes, and to train clinical forensic psychologists as mental health professionals to only treat and rehabilitate and victims of their families. Now, clinical forensic psychologists can also provide psychological therapies for the victims of crime and mental health services to their families following medical model, which is an ideal for victim protection and rehabilitation. See, when we talk of victim, it is the victim who suffers less, but it is their family who undergo lot of problems as far as mental health issues are concerned. So that is where a separate forensic mental health service units can be set up in medical and mental health institutes, behavioral science departments headed by mental health professionals. Now, this would enable the victim to avail psychological therapies and their families to avail the help of mental health professionals for a speedy recovery and a rehabilitation. When mental health professionals in a health setup or hospital setup can also cater to the medical health need of the relative by psychoeducation, family counseling, and forensic counseling. Now, when I talk of this forensic mental health service units, there is a need to prepare a new set of professionals, because already mental health professionals in India are overburdened with their own clinical population. So the best way is to prepare a new set of mental health professionals as clinical criminologists. And that is where I have introduced this new proposal. Neurocriminology module can be introduced for both reasoning and rehabilitation to treat only exclusively antisocial behavior, both as indoor and outdoor service in forensic mental health service units. Outdoor and indoor service facility needs to be created based on medical model, both in hospital, medical, prison, and juvenile home setups. Now, there is a need to train and create a cadre of clinical criminologists as new mental health professionals in India, as already practiced in Israel. Now, clinical psychologists and psychiatrists as mental health professionals with their training could have started these things long back to train clinical criminologists as mental health professionals under the health department. But somehow I said that they are already overburdened with their own clinical population and nobody has been able to spend time on this. Now, when forensic psychologists working in forensic setup have not trained or prepared any clinical criminologists as new mental health professional to provide psychological therapies for prison inmates and juveniles, there is no initiative taken to address the forensic mental health issues of the offenders and convicts for their mental well-being. And that is how probably the Raksha Shakti University has taken an initiative. And from the time Raksha Shakti University became a Rashtriya Raksha University, their initiative to start forensic mental health care services was one of the issues. Now, that is how Raksha Shakti University purchased the copyrights of neurocriminology model from Cognitive Center of Canada in 2016. And they introduced reasoning and rehabilitation model for treating antisocial behavior in their outdoor services in Institute of Research and Development. Now, Dr. Robert Ross, who is the director of Cognitive Center of Canada and a creator of this reasoning and rehabilitation program, he has joined School of Criminology and Behavioral Sciences of Rashtriya Raksha University in 2021 as an eminent resource faculty. Now, Rashtriya Raksha University has also introduced Postmaster's Advanced Professional Diploma in Neurocriminology from 2021-22 to train criminologists, psychologists, and mental health professionals seeking admission in this course. Now, Rashtriya Raksha University has also taken the initiative to open new frontiers in the School of Criminology and Behavioral Science. Now, it is not an easy job. There is a long, long process that we have to undergo. But Rashtriya Raksha University courses and vision, the next vision is licensing forensic mental health professionals under health department. Now, Rashtriya Raksha Shakti University has introduced Postmaster's Advanced Professional Diploma in Clinical Criminology to train and prepare clinical criminologists as future mental health professionals to treat and rehabilitate offenders, prison inmates, and juveniles. Now, clinical criminologists as mental health professionals would be trained in psychotherapeutic intervention with a clear objective of changing the mental structure to get the prisoners them there once more, and they try to use their positive potentials of their personality to lead a crime-free life. In due course of time, a new avenue needs to be opened under the health department for licensing clinical criminologists as mental health professionals for treating convicts, juveniles, and offenders in India, and there is an already model existing in Israel. Now, when Rashtriya Raksha Shakti University introduced post-master's clinical forensic psychology program to train and prepare clinical forensic psychologists as mental health professionals to treat and rehabilitate all victims of crime in hospital or medical mental health setup following the medical model, and in due course of time, a new avenue needs to be opened under health department or under Rehabilitation Council of India for licensing clinical forensic psychologists to treat and rehabilitate all victims of crime and their families with mental health services. Now, when I talk of Rashtriya Raksha Shakti University's initiative for forensic mental health services, we hope for a better society, and that is how Rashtriya Raksha Shakti University, as a university of national importance, has initiated to educate and prepare trained professional clinical criminologists as future forensic mental health professionals to treat and rehabilitate juvenile offenders, prisoners, and convicts. And professional clinical forensic psychologists will be trained as future mental health professionals to treat and rehabilitate mainly victims of all crimes. The forensic mental health service units is the only way that can take up the therapeutic jurisprudence for restoration of justice. Thank you so much for patient listening.